difference distinguish between ordinary sort of household dictionaries and a semanticist dictionary? And that's the first thing that we want to sort of get a handle on. What do we mean by a semanticist dictionary? So, you know, everyone's seen an ordinary dictionary, right? We've all looked up definitions in a, probably you all know an actual book-like dictionary as well as online dictionaries, okay? You know, we know how it tells us how to pronounce a word, it tells us it's part of speech, it also tells us its meaning, okay? But a semanticist dictionary is different, okay? It is supposed to represent important aspects of the mental knowledge about meaning that any typical native speaker might possess, okay? So that's really different, and it's a much more ambitious goal if you think about it. So your authors point out the problem of the interconnectedness of dictionary definitions. What do they mean by that? Did you catch that, or did you ever? Yeah,
go ahead. Kind of what I understood from it, I was a little confused about it, but it kind of sounded like when you have so many definitions in the dictionary that it's kind of bound to be kind of repetitive because definitions are made out of words, and so you have to have the definition of the words in that definition to know what the definition means.
Right. I think if I can wrap my brain around what you're saying. You're alluding to the problem just by the way you describe the problem, which is really nice. But I don't know, do any of you have a memory of the first time you looked up some of the earliest experiences you had looking up words in a dictionary and running into the problem that the words used to define the words were themselves words that you didn't know, right? So then you have to look up those words. And then those words will be defined in ways that might not be all that helpful.
The story of my life as an ESL student.
How many languages do you speak, Alexia?
As of right now, three that I can claim.
Okay.
Who are at work in progress.
English, Polish, and what else?
Romanian.
Wow.
Fantastic. I serve my mission.
That's awesome. Okay. So that's kind of what we're talking about when we talk about the interconnectedness of dictionary definitions, okay? So, so this is kind of what we were just talking about. That are break out of this pattern of circularity. In other words, you know, you're never supposed to use the word that you're defining in the definition itself. That's one form of circularity that you've probably heard about. But then another pattern of circularity is that, you know, you're using words which themselves need to be defined. And so how reliable is that as a tool for defining the words themselves? So to break out of this pattern of circularity, the semanticist might consider using some terms that won't need to be defined, which they call semantic primes. Now, your authors really don't talk about semantic primes very much. There's a little bit of mention in this chapter, but I wanted to talk about them in slightly more detail because they're interesting. There are people here in the Department of Linguistics who actually use semantic primes or semantic primitives in their work. So Dr. Parker uses them. I'm using them a little bit in my work on sound symbolic words. And there are also scholars around the world who use them. So Anna Rutzvicka, I don't know if I'm pronouncing your name right, at Australian National University, Ice Godard, also uses them. Okay? So what are semantic primes? Well, here's a nice little summary from Wikipedia. Semantic primes, or you could also call them semantic primitives, are concepts that are supposedly innately understood, okay, but they can't be expressed in simpler terms. So, you know, although the meaning of touching is readily understood, a dictionary might define touch as to make contact, right? So touching means make contact with the surface. But then it might define contact as touching. So that's the kind of circularity we're going into. Is there something more fundamental in touching or contact that we could zero in on with semantic primitives, okay? So, Wurzbicka's, she's got several books about this, and this is one of them, Semantics, Primes, and Universals. Cliff Godard, not As Godard. As Godard is a Native American scholar. Cliff Godard is another person. Yeah.
I just wanted to mention that Anna Wyszbicka, she's either Polish
or
she's
that how you pronounce
Yes, she's either Polish or she has a Polish heritage because
she's
that's a
Polish.
Pure Polish name.
How do you pronounce it again?
Wyszbicka.
Wyszbicka. Wyszbicka. Oh, that sounds so much better than Wyszbicka. Wyszbicka.
Thank you for telling me that.
She's got fascinating work, and she, have you ever heard of her before?
No, but I look at it and I know it's Polish.
Okay, no, you're absolutely right. And she's
because only Polish language has the letter RZ next to each other, so like it's Ż, Wyszbicka.
She's written a lot about what it was like to be from a Polish native language tradition and learning English for the first time. And
ooh, then I definitely have to look her up.
You need to look her up. She's really fascinating. So these are some of her semantic primes or semantic primitives. So supposedly, these are the elemental or atomic units of meaning, some of them, that all languages of the world might have. Okay, so notions like I, you, or someone, or person, or people, or you know, something or thing, or body or kind or part, right? This or the same or other, or quantifiers, right? So she's got all these categories, one, two, some, all, many, much. Evaluators, good, bad. Descriptors, big or small. Mental predicates, you know, to think, to know, to want, to feel, to see, to hear. Speech words, words like say, or words like word, or words like true, okay? And then words for actions, events, movement, contact, right? Do, happen, move. There's many, many more, okay? This is just a small sample. And then she's got also this notion of script, where she talks about how people activate these semantic primes and they have followed certain scripts. It's very complicated, so we won't go into that. But I just wanted to show you this partial list because she's not the first person to suggest something like this, right? We've talked a little bit about the Swadesh word list, haven't we? The list of words that all languages supposedly possess. And these are words that are least likely to be borrowed from one language to another because they're just universal. So, you know, a word like finger, or a word like moon, or a word like mother. These are sort of the basic vocabulary that all languages supposedly have, which would not be likely to be borrowed. And this is in one way in which historical linguists study the processes of language change, because they say, you know, if you've got two languages with and they both have the same word for mother, chances are they're related languages. They wouldn't, but one language wouldn't be likely to borrow another language's word for mother, right? Because those are just words that tend not to get borrowed, right? So this is sort of in the same tradition of, you know, looking for universals in language. Okay, here are a few more, you know, words for existence and possession, like, you know, there is, or there exists, or somebody has. And think of how hard it would be to communicate if you didn't have these concepts in your language, right? Live and die. Right? Words for time, like when, and the very word time itself. Although, you know, Quechua doesn't have a word for time. They had to borrow it from Spanish. So I, you know, as an anthropological linguist, I definitely argue with quite a few of these, just based on my knowledge of Quechua. But I don't think that she's saying that every language has to possess every one of them. But she's just saying that these tend to be the ones that are most likely to occur in languages. Okay. You know, notions of space, above, below, near, side, inside, touch. Logical concepts like not, or maybe, or because, or if. You know, intensifiers. And then also words for similarity. So, or sometimes people call this the similative case. Some languages have case markers that indicate similarity, okay? Yeah, so our authors consider semantic primes to be terms that ideally would categorize word meanings into sets, and they would consist of, you know, technical language, and then their special status would be indicated by an asterisk. And here would be some of the examples of semantic crimes that they suggested in this chapter. Sexed, right? Male versus female. I suppose it ought to include neuter there, because carrots don't have gender, right? There are some species of living things that don't have gender, and carrots don't, apparently. Did you guys know that?
They're non-binary.
Non-binary, yeah. This one is very interesting to me. Locomote, right? I mean, it kind of suggests a train to me, but I guess it's the term, you know, that she's using, or that the book authors are using for change location from one place to another. Yeah, Lee.
So the crime is locomote or sexed.
Exactly. Yeah. So these would be the words that are the semantic crimes or the semantic primitives. Mm-hmm. So you know, if you're an English speaker, of course, you would have words like walk, run, crawl, roll, tromp, stomp, tread, tiptoe, creep, trudge, traipse, step. Have you ever thought about how many verbs we have in English that indicate movement?
I love it.
Lots of them. You have a comment on that?
I just love it because then you can like specifically say how someone walked over you.
Yeah.
If they meander, then you know that they're like lazy. If they're moseying on over.
Yeah.
And they're probably
If they're trotting, they're eager, right?
Yeah.
So these are in English. I'm glad you raised that in English because I was going to go there myself. But in English, a lot of our verbs encode far more than simply the notion of changing location from one place to another, right? They encode manner of motion. All of these say something very, very specific about manner, or maybe even like visual pattern of motion, attitudinal aspects of motion, force of motion, right? Tiptoe is lightly forcing, but stomping is strongly forcing. Treading. You know, I don't know what you would say about versus trudging, traipsing. Traipsing seems kind of, I don't know, whimsical and almost haphazard, just traipsing around from one place to another. I seem to remember my mom saying that when she thought I was being too, going from one place to another-ish. So, you know, all of these verbs could be hyponyms or types of locomotion. Locomote, you know, the idea would be that locomote is the semantic primitive notion embedded in all of these, right? So, does that make sense? Okay. But ideas of locomotion are not always simple and straightforward, okay? So in that list that I just showed you, we've got ideas not only of movement, but manner, path, right? Attitude, so when you hear that somebody's moseying or sauntering, saunter suggests almost a kind of, what, arrogance or casual attitude, right? But you know, a manner of motion is not itself a simple idea. So for these verbs, it includes things like motor pattern, like rolling versus skipping, right? Rate of motion, running versus crawling. Attitude toward motion, sauntering versus strolling. Like I would say this, I don't know, what do you guys say about the difference between sauntering and strolling?
Strolling's relaxed, sauntering's a little more tranquil to it.
A little more what to it?
I don't know, it just seems like a little more.
To me, sauntering suggests people are parading themselves in front of others.
Yeah.
With really pridefully walking and displaying.
Like
strutting is another good one, yeah.
I think of sauntering as strutting, but with less, I guess, energy.
Less energy, more low-key strutting. Nice, I like that, yeah. That makes sense to me, too. But, so, these are really, really complex. And then strolling, you know, kind of leisurely, right? You're not skulking. You're not trying to hide yourself from other people. You're displaying yourself openly, right? And then degree of force, okay? All right, we also have the concept of path of motion, which is part of our verb structure, too. And that's a really interesting one. Right, so In English and some other Germanic languages, as well as Slavic, Celtic, and Finno-Ugric, passive motion may be expressed by prepositions. So linguists have come up with a typology of verbs, where they call these satellite-framed languages. Okay, this is the typology. So verb-framed, and it's way overly simplistic. Don't worry yourself about memorizing this. I'm just telling you, just kind of for your own information. So verb-framed and satellite-framed languages, and we already know that's way too simple, but we'll just keep it simple for now. So if you say, you know, they crept around the house, you've got the preposition after the verb encoding ideas of path of motion. We strolled up to the house, lemonade stand, that's path of motion. The owl flew out of the cave, that's the path of motion, right? And flying indicates the manner of motion, right? Does that make sense? So you've got very different kind of distinctions encoded in verbs, okay? And this is the kind of thing you have to kind of drive yourself crazy over when you start talking about semantic primitives. It almost makes you want to tear out your hair and say, is this really worth it, all this trouble that we're going through to isolate all these different things going on in language? In fact, last term I used this idea of semantic primitives as an extra credit problem on the midterm. And some people did some interesting things with it, and other people didn't quite get it at all. Some people thought semantic primitives were just like synonyms of a word. They're not. They're not synonyms. They're like ice. They're like little atoms of meaning that a word or a lexeme itself is presupposing. You could say it has in itself. Okay. So try to take this idea to heart, because I'm thinking about using it as an extra credit question. Now, I would like give you a word or something and say, analyze how many semantic primitives can you find embedded in this word. Okay, that would be something to.
Yeah. So what would be an example of that? Like, so.
Like
you
what
give
we're
a word,
doing right now.
So you give a word like around or.
No, it would be something. It would be more likely a verb of some kind.
Okay.
Yeah, that we haven't talked about.
So kind of like with walk, and then we would be like stroll, stomp. All these things? Is that what?
No. So you would need to come up with your own ideas of, say, star terms that would enter into the notion of walk. Like, what did we say? What did we say the semantic primitive underlying walk was? Or what?
Locomote.
Right. Mm-hmm. So you would say, okay, idea of locomoting is there. What else?
Oh, I see. So you wouldn't give us walk, you would give us stroll.
Well, I won't give you walk now just because you mentioned it. Right.
It'll be something else besides, like, in the realm of locomote.
Yeah, it might be something. It might involve a motion verb. It might involve something else. But what? Let's say we did take walk as our word, okay? And you had to identify semantically locomote. And you had to identify semantic primitives involved in the idea of walking. What besides locomoting would have to be a necessary ingredient of walking? They walked very quickly up to the ice cream stand. I don't know if slowness is necessarily part of it. Think more deeply. Peel more layers back from the onion.
Animation.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you could do, I don't know if it's too broad, but like space and time, those ones that we talked about, because it's got to take time and moving from one location to another.
You have to move across space to be walking, right? And there has to be some kind of temporality, because it's not just something that occurs instantaneously, right?
Except you can walk on a treadmill and then you're not moving anywhere.
If you can walk on the treadmill. Great. I mean, you're walking, you're still walking within a defined space, mm-hmm. right? Yeah.
So are you going to give us a list, like a category, like a set of words, and we're going to work with it, or are you going to give
probably
us
just one word? Because it's always interesting to see how different people treat the word. And then, you know, when we finished correcting the exam last time, what I did was I made a list of all the semantic primitives that people came up with, and some people came up with 3 or 4, and some people came up with like 7 or 8. And then once we made the entire list, there were like 15 or 16 for like one verb. And people were really surprised about, wow, I never thought that word encoded so many necessary ideas within its meaning. It was a really cool kind of exercise. So yeah, and you know, when I said walk, you probably didn't think about these ideas. Anything else with walking, I'm thinking of something.
To me, it has to be the feet.
Yes, yes, yes. There have to be feet involved, right? And if it involves feet, what else must it involve?
Inanimate
muscles of your legs and your body.
Animate.
Isn't, I think animate is already embedded in the idea of locomotion. But that's a good thought. Maybe we even have subprimes here. I actually think locomote might be too big a prime. It might be breakdownable into more different terms. But if you have an idea of feet, what else might you have an idea of? Alive. Yeah. Alive. Feet. Okay. Let's go. Somebody said legs.
Alive.
It's true. Feet have to really have the legs for walking to take place. Might we say something like feet / body? Or let's use this term, embody, okay? Embodied, and then feet is a particular way in which it's embodied, right? Involving feet. Okay, so it's an idea involving the human body, right?
What about like purpose or destination? Where would those go under locomote?
Purpose or destination? She walked aimlessly. Not necessarily. Although
There's still a
voluntary movement from one place to another. All right, I'll go along with that. Purpose. Yeah. Let's do that. Let's do purpose.
Or maybe
because you don't go somewhere without having an intention. That's true. Yeah. Well, yeah, go ahead.
Power or energy?
Energy, yeah. That's good. Yeah, what were you going to say?
Maybe like direction. I think that's kind of similar to purpose, but I think, like you were saying, you can walk aimlessly, and that would be purposeless, but if you always have
you
to
mean
have
physical direction, like spatial?
Oh, yeah, I guess that kind of...
Yeah, I think that would go with space, because it has to happen in space. What about feet, though? There's still something involving feet that you guys haven't talked about.
Ground.
Contact with the ground. Did you say that?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Contact, right? Contact between surfaces. Okay, we can stop there. But we could probably even think about more if we really wanted to. Do you see how unsimple this idea really is, semantically, if we really stretch ourselves. Okay. Good. All right. So do you see the difference between semantic primitives and synonyms? So if I say give me semantic primes of walk, don't say stroll or saunter. Okay? Those would be synonyms, I suppose, or yeah, they could be used fairly synonymously, maybe not very synonymously. What's the relationship between all of these verbs, like creeping and crawling and traipsing and trotting to the notion of locomote? Hyponyms up, right? These are all types of locomoting. Okay.
So there's this really cool website that doesn't do exactly like this, but it's called WordNetWeb from Princeton University. And they have quite a few words, and verbs obviously have the most. And you can click on it, and it will show all the types of hypernyms and hyponyms of everything.
That's very cool. WordNetWeb.
Yeah.
.com.
I had. I just opened it. So.
Find us the link. WordNetWeb.com. Yeah, we should look that up.
I could show you right now. WordNetWeb.princeton.edu.
Okay. Great. Yeah, it would be fun to look at that, and that'll give your give yourself a chance to appreciate linkages between words. Let's get back to this this thing that we were talking about, how in English we talk about the manner of motion in the verb and the path of motion in the satellite or the preposition, right? Now we're not talking about phrasal verbs here, right? Does everybody see that these are not the same as the phrasal verbs we talked about in class yesterday? These are different because here the preposition really does have prepositional meaning. Whether the owl flew or whether the owl flew out, he's still doing the same action of flying. Okay, so don't get tripped up by that. But the important thing is that not all languages, you know, build up their verbs this way. So in Spanish, you would say, el búho salió de la cueva volando. So the owl exited or left the cave flying, okay? So that's really different from the way English would say it. So the manner of motion is here, right? And then the path of motion is here. Okay, so you would call Spanish a verb framed language instead of a satellite framed language. But again, it's way too small. So languages vary, you know, in a number of ways. They're patterned enough to make certain kinds of semantic primitives like locomote relevant, okay? But not maybe completely telling the whole story, okay? Because motion is, you know, motion is entangled with other kinds of notions, sometimes so much so that it becomes difficult to untangle them and tell them apart from each other. Okay, your authors also suggest that shake, twitch, and sway are different enough from other motion verbs, so we need another semantic prime for them. So this is my suggestion for shake, twitch, because there's some kind of motion that really does go, you know, fairly extensively from one place to another, and then there's other kinds of motions, usually bodily motions. I mean, you can only move your arms so far away from your body, right? You can only move your fingers so far away from your hand. So we could call these kinds of verbs limited translocations, limited changes of place, right? And then they also suggest, and I really don't like this at all, they suggest deliberate noise-making activity with the vocal tract as a semantic primitive for sing, talk, speak, shout, whisper, and mutter. I think that this idea of noise has very negative semantic prosody, right? Noise. Why not say sound-making, right? So I would suggest communicate sound would be a more economical way, you know, to say this, right? We've only got two words here, whereas we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 words. Okay. Yeah.
I agree that your term is much more economical and feels clearer, but there are kinds of sounds that are communicated that aren't made with our own vocal pattern. So bells or different whistles. That can be used.
Right.
So, yeah.
But then, does this notion necessarily mean it has to be a human vocal tract? Because birds communicate certain kinds of messages, right?
Yeah. No, I just think that they're trying to group things, sounds that human makes, that humans make, with their voice.
With their voice. Oh, so. Okay. Yeah. I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Technically, I can communicate with sound with my body by tapping out things with my hands in Morse code, but that's not
with the vocal tone.
All the same thing as speaking, really.
Right.
I don't know. It's, yeah, that is a very cumbersome way to say it, though.
Right. Plus, this whole idea of noise, right? We're going to say something else.
So maybe communicative sound is one prime of this group, but it's not the only one.
Not the only one. So yeah.
Sounded language.
Sounded language.
Because all these other things are ways to communicate, which is like the language that makes sound, but it doesn't necessarily rely on vocal tract or exclude vocal tract.
Right.
Aren't
communicative
vocals.
What?
Are all vocal sounds made to communicate? That's
well, that's an interesting question. It depends on who you ask. Some people would say that when you say oops and eek and yike, that you're just spontaneously letting your emotions flow out because you can't help yourself. Other people would say that's deliberately communicative because you're